Thank you so much for coming tonight. I love to talk, and Michael asked me if I was going to do a PowerPoint, and I said, oh, I'll try. But historians tell stories, and I'm going to be telling the story of what went on in Russia in the beginning of the 20th century. What we call the Russian Revolution actually was a series of three revolutions. And I'll talk a little bit about what I call the backstory. And that's because when I talk to people about Russia, many of them don't know why Russia got involved in a revolution in 1917. So bear with me. I'm not the most linear person. I'll wander off down the paths of storytelling. I mean, I'll tell you a great story to start with. When I'm talking about the Russian Revolution in Russia, and I talk about why people in the United States were so opposed to the communist revolution, because why would you think it would affect the United States? Well, somehow, in my grandfather's family, and they were a poor family, somebody owned 10,000 shares of a Russian railroad company, issued in 1903. Well, when the Russian communists came to power in 1917, a nickel is worth more than that certificate that I still own. Okay? So that's why people were afraid of the Russian Revolution and communism. So the Russian state, Russia, was a huge country. It stretched 17 time zones from St. Petersburg all the way to opposite Alaska. In the middle of the 19th century, they had a single railroad track that went from St. Petersburg to the Far East. Now, to give you an idea of how backward Russia was, Russia's railroad system was built not by entrepreneurs or capitalists. It was built primarily with foreign investment and government money. And it was built in sections. And each section had a different gauge railroad track. Okay, so you'd go several hundred miles, and everybody would climb off the train, walk a couple hundred yards, climb on another train. So it was backward. It was decadent. It was a society in which people of wealth dominated and truly abused the poorer people underneath them. Russia was vulnerable to revolution, both in 1905, and I'm going to talk about that revolution also, but in 1917, not just because of being involved in the First World War. There were a lot of countries involved in the First World War, and only four of them had revolutions. Now, the fact that three of the four were on the losing side should tell you something. The winners are usually happy. Russia nominally was on the winning side, but in the midst of the war, it suffered a revolution. There's another major reason that Russia was subject to revolution by 1905 and 1917. And that's because Russia had undergone industrialization at a pace that was too rapid for them to take care of people. And then as I tell you, I'm not very linear. You go back to the typical ideas about the Industrial Revolution. It took place beginning in England in the 1760s, 1770s. It took place over several hundred years. And yes, there were abuses, but eventually people in England, people in Germany, people in France figured out if you wanted to keep your country together, you had to provide some sort of safety net, some sort of benefits for workers. When the Russians industrialized, they basically ignored that part of history. Russia also had a really extraordinary relationship with the people in Russia. Russia in the mid-19th century, only 25% of the people in Russia were what we call free. 12 million out of 48 million. The others were what they called serfs. Not like my students say, smurfs, but serfs, right? They were the equivalent of slaves. So you had Russians enslaving other slaves. So I'm going to talk about that. Another factor that led to revolution is that Russia had practically no education prior to the late 19th century. But they began to have a minimal education system because when you have factories, you at least have to have people who can read minimal directions or look at the clock or know how to follow directions. Problem with education is, minimal as it was, it increased the number of people with an education creating more really truly educated people than the Russian system had time or space for. So the educated people had ideas, they'd read about Rousseau, they'd read about Locke, they'd read about Voltaire, and they couldn't do anything to change the system in Russia. They became disillusioned, they despaired of ever achieving meaningful reforms, and most of them by the 1880s and 1890s were willing to resort to violence, what we now call terrorism, to try to implement change. There was also nationalism. Russia had over 200 linguistic groups and 160 ethnicities in those 17 time zones. Can you imagine trying to rule a country that big with a czar who spoke only Russian? And I'll give you a hint, one of the czar's people who liked him, we're talking Tsar Nicholas II, said Tsar Nicholas has two great characteristics. Anybody know what they were? The czar of all the Russians, the czar by 1917 of 200 million people. What do you think the characteristics of that ruler were that a friend of his praised? He was a good father and a good horseman. Okay, those are not characteristics you need to rule a people of 200 million with 200 different languages. Ethnic Russians were the majority, sorry, not the majority of the country, but they were the dominant people who were in government positions. The aristocrats were primarily Russian. The Tsar was Russian. The language of instruction in the schools was Russian. Nationalism had come to fore in the time of Napoleon Bonaparte, and by the late 19th century, these different ethnic groups in Russia, especially as you add in education, they were beginning to accept a different vision of the future. Not being part of this huge multi-ethnic, multinational empire, but to have their own little, tiny, independent, ethnically pure countries. That's what nationalism was about a lot in the 19th century. So Russia got into this mess over several hundred years. But I'm going to give you a couple features that I think are key into why Russia had a revolution in 1917. And I have to be very careful when I say that, because Russia actually did have a revolution in 1905, and I'll talk about that. And it actually had two revolutions in 1917. So how'd they get there? Well, I mentioned serfdom. Serfdom had been part of Russian history for years, okay? As I said, only one quarter of Russia's population in the mid-19th century was free. That is, they could move where they wanted to, they could marry whom they wanted to, unless their fathers told them differently. But 36 million people were under the control of people who owned them. Many of them were what they called state peasants. They worked on land that belonged to the Tsar. They worked on land that belonged to the Russian Orthodox Church. They weren't quite as downtrodden as the other serfs. They had to work a certain number of days each year to pay for the land that they used as their farms and their homes. Now, the problem was the state serfs had to work when either the government officials or the church told them when they had to work. That usually was at harvest. Anybody here ever worked on a hay harvest? Okay? You know, it's cut, it's dried, it's tedded, it's raked, and then you have to go get it. All right? If someone says, oh no, you have to go get my hay, your hay could be ruined. So they weren't as happy as they might have been. The other serfs, okay, had no rights at all. They literally were part of the property that they farmed. They didn't own the land. Their families might have been on that land for generations. And they didn't pay rent, but they had to work for the person who owned the land. They had to work for the person who owned them. They had to provide a share of their crop to the person who owned the land. And they technically, if you look at Russian law, they could not be sold unless they were sold as part of the land, the way if you sold a cottage or a house or a barn. But Russian law didn't protect the serfs. So serfs often were bought and sold the way African slaves were sold in the United States. The Tsar would send out request for men for the army. The Russian army required a service of 25 years. The life, average life expectancy for a Russian serf was under 40 years. So if your Russian master basically said, you, you're in the army now. You couldn't marry, you couldn't have a family, and you probably would die before you got back home again. Russian serfs also faced sexual exploitation by their owners. And so the owner, when he found out a young, attractive serf girl was getting married, could demand the right of the first night. Okay? Which meant he got to have sex with the bride before the husband did. Led to a lot of anger, a lot of resentment, a lot of pent-up resistance, however, because the peasants had no way to resist. If the army service had been shorter, you could say that men who'd served in the army, had learned how to handle weapons, had learned how to fight, could come back and lead the resistance. But the men in the army, as I said, they went into the army and they pretty much died in the army. Another problem for serfs is that the Tsar had given absolute control over life and death of the serfs. So if an owner of a serf killed him, he wasn't responsible. And an even worse punishment in the eyes of the serfs was that the owner could say to the Tsar, I have a serf who's really out of line, he's really disobedient, or in one case, and this is an actual fact, who spilled soup on one of my guests at my dinner party, I want you to send the serf to Siberia. And the Tsar would. Okay, serfs were not happy people. Landlords were quick to crack down on any appearance of dissatisfaction. There had been peasant riots in the 18th century and early in the 19th century. But those riots were not directed against the Tsar. The Tsar had like this bubble. Most peasants saw the Tsar as a replacement for God on earth. A peasant nickname for the Tsar translated as our little God. Not demeaning to the big God, but the Tsar was God's representative on earth. So when things went wrong, they didn't blame the Tsar. They blamed the aristocrats, they blamed the landlords, they blamed anybody else. And they believed if they somehow could just get to the Tsar and let him know what was going on in their lives, he would do something to fix it. Well, the Tsars pretty much didn't care. Tolstoy was a Russian novelist. Many of you may have read his books, very depressed about the state of Russian affairs. But in 1865, just 2 years after the Tsar ended serfdom, and I'll give you some detail on that, why it wasn't so great to end it, but anyway, Tolstoy said, the next peasant revolution, all right, wouldn't actually be against the Tsar or even the aristocracy. It would be over land ownership. And that was because when the Tsar eliminated serfdom in 1863, he literally said to his advisors, it's better to remove it from above than have them attempt to remove it from below. So he was wise enough to see there was dissatisfaction and he needed to do something about it. So he freed the serfs, except he didn't give them the land that they had been farming, some of them for generations. They had to continue to pay the so-called owners of the land, or they had to pay the Tsar himself if they had been state peasants. This was a potential hotspot. 80% of these peasants did not own any land. They got a document that said, you're free. And yet they weren't free, because not only did they not own the land, they had to pay something that the Tsar came up with the idea that he had to compensate those wealthy people for taking their property away from them. Not the land, the people. And so the peasants had to pay what were called redemption payments. These were totally separate. They weren't buying land with redemption payments. They were paying for their freedom. The redemption payments were to last 49 years. Life expectancy was what? 40? So that meant that if someone was an adult at the time of freedom, the redemption payments maybe went to his children or even to his grandchildren. Another problem for the peasants. because now we can call them peasants and not serfs, is that control over decisions on land use, like what you were going to grow, was left to a council of village elders. Now, most of you are my age or older, and the reputation we have is being a little conservative. Okay? Well, in this period, the village elders might have a young and upcoming farmer who would say, you know what, I really think I want to grow turnips rather than wheat, because turnips last longer, they don't rot, they don't get ergot, and the village elders would go, nobody's ever grown turnips before. We don't know if you're going to be able to make enough money growing turnips to pay your share of the redemption payments, so no, you can't grow turnips. If a peasant wanted to invest in agricultural machinery, he would have to go to the elders, and the elders would say, well, no, you can't afford that machinery because you're not going to be able to pay the redemption payments. This went on from 1863 right up until the turn of the 20th century. Russians, some of them educated, began to see there was a problem. They tried to advocate for the peasants, that the peasants be allowed to purchase land, or that the Tsar compensate. I mean, the Tsar had an incredible amount of wealth. And I say the Tsar, there were three different Tsars in this period. Alexander III, Alexander IV, and then Nicholas II, okay? There's not gonna be a test you don't need to remember, all right? But with these intellectuals, they basically said the same thing Tolstoy did. These people are unhappy, and if you don't do something for them, they are going to become violent. And that was one of the factors behind the revolution of 1905, and it was a major factor behind the two revolutions in 1916. Now, what else could go wrong in this situation? Peasants who were serfs were pretty prolific in producing children, okay? Because they didn't know about birth control, and in a farm environment, the more children you have, the more labor you have. Well, between the ending of serfdom and the end of the century, so that's about 40 years, the peasant population doubled to 126 million peasants. They got no more land, okay? So here were families that doubled in less than 50 years, and they couldn't provide for their children. Were there any positives that came out of this political freeing of the serfs? In the minds of the serfs, probably not. But for people who wanted to modernize Russia, one of the things you need for industrialization is a free, mobile, laboring population. And these surplus young males, in that doubling of the peasant population from the mid-1860s to the mid-1890s, were young men. They knew they weren't going to get any land, because one, their fathers didn't own it, and even if the father subdivided the land, you didn't have enough of a rented farm to be able to support a family. So these mobile young men, and it was primarily the men, moved to the urban areas of Russia. They did provide potential labor force as Russia went through an industrial revolution, started producing goods and stuff in factory settings. Russia in this time period also reorganized the army. And again, I'm not always linear, I'm gonna go back. In the 1850s, Russia had fought Britain and France in the Crimean War, all right? The charge of the Light Brigade into the Valley of Death rode the 10,000. Russia lost terribly. Russia lost embarrassingly. And in this period, it's after Charles Darwin had come up with his theory of the origin of species and the survival of the fittest. And people began to apply those ideas, which Darwin meant for sparrows and tortoises and marine iguanas, to people and to countries. And the idea was a country that could beat other countries was better, was superior, was going to come out on top. Russia had lost the Crimean War badly. It lost face. I mean, it was the largest empire in Europe, largest empire, because China was so disorganized at that point. But it was not successful as a military power. So they looked at what was wrong with the army, and they said, okay, part of the problem is there's no incentive for men in the army to do any better. They get in, they know they're going to stay till they die. So they change the term of service to 6 years. They still basically forced people into the army. It wasn't a volunteer army. If people didn't volunteer, the Tsar's soldiers would just go out into the countryside and pick people up, like the British used to impress people for the British Navy. But it also required former soldiers to be part of a military reserve and do a certain number of days of military training each year. That was important in 1914. This opened the door to rapid change. But Russia was still looking for a way to restore its prestige. In southeastern Europe, and this is, you've got to come to Avery Point. Anybody who's over 62, we have free senior citizen waivers. You can come and sit in our class. You don't have to do the papers. You don't have to do the tests. You can do the reading or not. But come to my class in the fall. With this situation, Russia was so far behind, it couldn't catch up. It was behind in terms of level of education. It was behind in terms of its industrialization. The railroad was still extraordinarily backward. And on top of all this, the Tsar was a total absolute monarch. Russia did not have a parliament. Russia didn't have an independent judiciary. The Tsar was responsible for appointing all the aristocrats, for appointing the officers in the army. He had the ultimate say in everything that went on in Russia. And by the 1890s, that Tsar was Nicholas II, the man whom I said was a good father and a good horseman. Russians had no civil liberties. They had no political liberties. They had no representative assemblies. They had an internal passport system that limited travel within the country. The Tsar periodically crushed any nationalist yearnings in areas like Crimea, Ukraine, Uzbekistan. He was an absolute, everyone under his thumb, autocrat. This had led people prior to when Nicholas II came to power to assassinate his grandfather. These were members of the educated elite, whom I mentioned earlier. They basically found there was no way to implement meaningful change within the system, and some of them turned to what we would call terrorism, bombing sites, and eventually succeeding in assassinating Alexander III. They, in effect, declared war against the Tsar and his bureaucracy. All that really happened is that the Tsar's secret police cracked down and sent people in exile to Siberia, which was pretty much a death sentence. Industrialization, as I said, was slow. It was backward. Russia had literally, when I told you they had that one single track, you could not do two trains at the same time. They had a couple sidings. So if you had a train going from west to east, and there was a train coming from east to west, and their telegraph system was really awful. So sometimes they would, come up together, and someone would have to back up to a siding. Not an efficient way to run a government. But gradually, in the 19th century, Russia began to improve. In 1861, in that entire country, there were 10,000 factories. Most of them were small, fewer than 50 employees. Their total output, was about 200 million rubles. 45 years later, there were 40,000 factories, some of them employing thousands of people, and the output of those factories was 4 billion rubles. Unfortunately, that growth was primarily in Moscow and St. Petersburg. So it meant a concentration of these detached, disoriented former peasants who'd gone to the cities to try to get work. Living and working conditions were terrible. I don't know if you ever have had someone ask you about the difference between standard of living and quality of life. Standard of living is, are you making more money this year than last year? If last year you could buy 2 pigs and everybody had a new suit of clothes, and this year you could buy 4 pigs and everybody had 2 suits of clothes, your standard of living has gone up. Quality of life is, how are you living? Are you living in a basement? Are you living literally hanging your sleeping hammock from the rafters of a basement because it was insufficient housing for the workers? this was happening to workers in Moscow and St. Petersburg. There was no health insurance. The factories had no safety precautions. They cost too much. There were more laborers than they needed, so they paid below a minimum wage. So a young man working for himself literally couldn't make enough money to survive. Some of them tried to organize unions, strikes. The Tsar outlawed them. He sent people who went out on strike to Siberia. I mean, this was a heavy, heavy-handed guy. So this led workers to begin to listen to those members of the educated class who said, we need change. And one of the changes the members of the educated class advocated was socialism, both utopian socialism and Karl Marx's scientific socialism. The idea that the workers were the ones who contributed the greatest value when they were taking raw materials and turning them into finished goods. So workers were dissatisfied. The intellectuals had really nothing they could do. And by the time Nicholas II became Tsar, there were two underground political parties. And I told you, I give this dense background, but we are getting to the revolution, okay? Two political parties organized. Now, the really bizarre thing about this is every political party in Russia and outside Russia had Tsarist secret agents attending the meetings, okay? So the Tsar knew everything they were doing. But anyway, they tried to organize. One was the Social Revolutionary Party. These were members of the intelligentsia, the educated, but they looked to workers as the source, sorry, peasants, as the source for true revolutionary activity. They weren't Marxist socialists in the sense that they looked for the, you know, revolution of the proletariat over the middle class. They basically said, our revolution is going to start with the peasants, because the peasants want their land. You're not going to have to go through any bourgeois capitalist stage. You don't even have to read Karl Marx. The peasants are going to get mad as hell, and they're going to overthrow the system. The Social Democratic Labor Party was a more Karl Marx socialist group. They gave up on the peasants because they recognized that if you ever did give the peasants the land, they would cease to be revolutionary. Because what peasants wanted was the land. And if you gave them the land or they seized the land, why would they ever want a revolution again? So the Social Democratic Labor Party basically said, we're going to look to the workers. We're going to follow the model of Karl Marx, and we're going to call for a worker revolution. The problem was, at the end of the 19th century, workers in the factories in Russia made up less than 0.2% of the population. Okay? 200 million people, 0.2% of the population. It's not a recipe for success. So in this period, most of the leaders of both of those parties were in exile. In the Social Democratic Labor Party in Switzerland in 1903, they held a meeting. Lenin was there. Okay? He was in exile in Switzerland. There were at least three Tsarist agents at the meeting as well. Okay? The Bolsheviks and the Mensheviks were two different groups at this meeting. Now, the word Bolshevik in Russian actually transfers as a majority. Lenin led the Bolsheviks. They were not the actual majority within the Social Democratic Labor Party, but at that particular meeting, on that particular day, there were more Bolsheviks than there were Mensheviks. So Lenin basically ran the meeting. What he wanted was a party run by a small political elite. He wanted a party dedicated to the ideology of Karl Marx. Overthrow the capitalists, world revolution, workers of the world unite, you have nothing to lose but your chains. He was opposed to any social reforms for workers because he recognized that if workers got one step up on that ladder to success, to prosperity, they wouldn't be so revolutionary. I mean, Bismarck learned this in Germany in the 1880s when he implemented old age insurance, widows' pensions, unemployment compensation. And reform socialists basically did not want to overthrow the world. They wanted more and more what everybody else already had. So Lenin and his group said, we're not going to give them reforms. We're going to keep them unhappy, angry, and then they're going to lead the revolution. The Mensheviks, And the, one of the leaders of the Mensheviks at this point was Trotsky. Trotsky is a pseudonym. It was Lev Brushnik, thank you. But they needed pseudonyms because, well, the spies who knew they were anyway, but they used pseudonyms. But the Mensheviks really wanted social reform. They were much more like Germany's Social Democratic Party. They wanted to pull reforms if they could for the workers. They wanted everybody in the party to vote. They wanted a democratic structure for the party. And they were willing to work with anybody else to achieve their goals. Trotsky and Lenin played critical roles in 1917. 1904, I'm jumping forward, Russia had another chance to prove it was on the top. It had expanded throughout the eastern region of Siberia and had run into the Japanese, who were expanding into the Sakhalin Peninsula and Korea. And the Russians thought, well, you know, a quick, dirty war that we win will distract everybody from everything that's going wrong at home. And so the Russians declared war on the Japanese, figuring the Japanese were not European, they were not going to be an effective, you know, opponent, that they weren't industrialized, they weren't militarized. Wrong, 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 wrong. Russia lost badly again. And not only was Russia losing badly, Russia was losing badly to a third world people. It was bad enough to lose to the British and the French in the Crimean War. Here they were losing to the Japanese. It was a humiliating defeat. The Russian fleet in the East was totally destroyed. Moreover, the prices went soaring because the Tsar basically commandeered food supplies to send the troops out in the eastern part of Siberia. So food prices went soaring in the cities. Peasants began to hoard their food because if the Tsar knew they had food, the Tsar would just take their food. These are not happy people. 1905, what did I tell you ordinary people viewed the Tsar as? Little God, their father, the caring Tsar who would look after them. In January of 1905, in the middle of the Russo-Japanese War, a Russian Orthodox priest, Father George Gapon, led a peaceful march of several thousand people to the square in front of the Tsar's palace in St. Petersburg. He had a petition. This crowd was primarily women, religious people, children, not that many men because the factory work went on at night. And they went there with a petition asking for justice and protection. Part of the petition literally said this: we are impoverished and oppressed. Unbearable work is imposed upon us. We are despised and not even recognized as human beings. Well, the little God wasn't there to receive the petition. He got frightened and he actually wasn't even in the palace. Imperial officers ordered the imperial troops to fire at the crowd. Several hundred died, hundreds more were killed, and many of those dead were women and children. This is the day called Bloody Sunday. It marked the start of the revolution of 1905. And when I teach at UConn, I have to be really careful if I say, you know, why did the revolution occur in Russia? And if I don't say why did the revolution of 1905, or the first revolution of 1917, or the second revolution of 1917, they always like to go to the revolution of 1905. It's easy to figure out why it happened. The most important part of this revolution was not the minimal reforms that the Tsar imposed, but it destroyed that myth of the gentle, caring Tsar. The myth that the Tsar was going to be a buffer between peasants and the landlords, between workers and the grasping capitalists. Russians began to see the Tsar as part of the problem facing Russia. Protesters shut down St. Petersburg in a general strike. The Tsar did grant some temporary concessions. As soon as he was back in control, he basically pulled back all those concessions. So where was Russia in the summer of 1914 at the outbreak of the First World War? It was a divided, fragile society. It was a country that needed a public relations coup. It was at the bottom of the pack after the Crimean War. It was at the bottom of the pack after the Russo-Japanese War. Well, I apologize for not being linear, but I mentioned before that Russia had also started to expand its influence in the southeastern part of Europe, the Balkans, Romania, Bulgaria, Serbia, Slovenia. Russia held itself out to these peoples as the great mother of the Slavs. We will protect you from nasty Austria-Hungary. We will protect you from nasty Germany. We will protect you from the nasty Europeans who want to come and exploit you. Russia believed that it had enough power and influence at least to affect what went on in southeastern Europe. When Austria-Hungary issued its ultimatum to Serbia following the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand, summer of 1914, Russia sent a diplomatic note to Serbia that basically said, we will back you, whatever happens. If Austria invades you, we'll help you. We'll send you money. We'll send you troops. Don't worry. We're there for you. Problem was, Kaiser William II of Germany said the same thing to Austria-Hungary. If you decide to go to war against Serbia, we will back you to the hilt all the way to war. That is what, in the terms of the First World War, diplomats called the blank check. And most people have forgotten that Russia said the same thing to Serbia, because Germany lost, and the losers are the ones who pay for losing. So Russia started to mobilize. There's a problem. I already mentioned the problem with the railroad. Now, by 1914, Russia had some more railroads. But Russia, when it mobilized, had to mobilize everyone. Russia shared a border with the eastern part of Germany. Poland did not exist in this point. Okay? Russia owned the eastern part of Poland. Germany owned the western part. So Russia mobilized, starting from where Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia are, right all the way down to Bulgaria and Romania. Now, William II and Nicholas II were cousins, and Nicholas II's wife was William's niece. So we had this wonderful exchange of telegrams and notes. Dear cousin Nikki, dear cousin Willie. But it got up and up and up. And finally, Wilhelm said to the Tsar of Russia, of all the Russians, if you don't stop your mobilization, we're going to declare war on you. From what I've said about Russia, why didn't Russia back down at that point? They were already two-time losers. To back away from this, when they had the largest army in the world, they believed that they would prevail. They also, when I say they, the leadership, the military leadership, the Tsar, they wanted a war because there was so much dissatisfaction. You look at history throughout the world, political leaders often will look for a war to distract people from what's going on at home. Don't have enough food, don't have enough housing, nobody has jobs, let's have a good war. So not only the Tsar and the political leaders, but many of the radicals, even those people who'd been involved in the terrorist acts, it's amazing when you read the documents, they actually wrote to each other and say, let's support the Tsar. Let's beat Germany, let's beat Austria. Because when he's done, the Tsar is going to have to be so grateful to us, he'll give us the reforms we want. Air dreamers, moon spinners. It never would have happened, even if the Tsar had not lost his life, had not lost the revolution. Why did Russia do so badly? Russia had the largest army in the world. Eventually, okay, it mobilized over 15 million men. 15 million, all right? It had more men on the Eastern Front, that's Germany's Eastern Front, Russia's Western Front, than Germany did, all right? The problem was in supplies and training and mobility. Russia couldn't move its troops rapidly. Russia had more than two times the men on the Eastern Front, Germany's Eastern Front, one-fifth the artillery, one-third of the machine guns. Training was sketchy at best, and there were not enough weapons. Any of you gentlemen or ladies been in the military? Okay. I want you to imagine going to the front carrying a wooden rifle. Okay? They didn't have enough guns, so they said to the guys who didn't have guns, carry this. And when the guy next to you with a gun gets shot and killed, pick up his gun, and then you've got a gun. Okay? Would you go to battle feeling very confident in your abilities? No. Or would you kill the guy next to you first to get the gun? All right? Supplying the army led to the same kind of food shortages for civilians that had happened in the Russo-Japanese War. This contributed to feeling against the Tsar in the cities. The numbers are appalling. I told you they mobilized 15 million men. By the end of the war, 6 to 8 million of them had died or been wounded or had ended up as prisoners of war. Another 2 million had deserted. So do the math. 15 million mobilized. Take the upper number, 8 dead, wounded, or in prisoner of war camps, and another 2 ran away. They didn't have a lot left. The most notable thing about this, however, wasn't the death. Russia did not collapse in the field in the first 2 years of the war. They managed to keep an army in the field. The really radical outcome was it radicalized the workers and the peasants who joined the army. It taught them how to fight. It taught them how to use weapons. And war weariness set in. It set in everywhere. If you come to the other lectures, you'll learn that in the Western Front in France, and this is from the terms of Germany, French soldiers baaed like sheep when their commanders ordered them out of the trenches into the field to attack the German trenches. Other Frenchmen refused to go over the top and basically said, look, shoot me right here. Because if you shoot me right here, there's a body to send home to my wife. If I go up there, there'll be nothing left of me but little pieces of protoplasm. Nicholas was a poor leader. Good horseman, good father. His most critical mistake was to leave the running of the government to his German-born wife, Alexandra. And he went to the front to take personal control of his army. Good father, good horseman. That does not translate into good military leader. Rasputin's another total story. Haven't got the time to go into it. But Rasputin was an advisor to the Tsar and the Tsarina. After the Tsar was at the front, he made some really bizarre recommendations that the majority of Russians saw as pro-German. Alexandra was originally German. She's a granddaughter of Queen Victoria. And people began to suspect her of sabotaging the military, of being a spy, trying to destroy Russia. And so Russian aristocrats in December of 1916 assassinated Rasputin. But Rasputin had warned the Tsar that someone was going to kill him. And he said, if my own people, the peasants, kill me, your reign will continue forever. But if the aristocrats, if your people kill me, your kingdom will collapse in 6 weeks. It took about 3 months. But the Tsar was so disheartened by the death of Rasputin, he basically did nothing. In March, okay, of 1917, March 8th, 10,000 women, doesn't seem like a lot after the Women's March a couple weeks ago, 10,000 women marched in the streets of what they were now calling Petrograd, because St. Petersburg sounded too German, to protest the war. The army officers called on their troops to fire on the women. In 1905, the troops had fired on the protesters at the Winter Palace. In 1917, they didn't. 2 days later, 300,000 Russians filled the streets of Petrograd, protesting against the Tsar, protesting against the war, and against the oppression of Russian society. And the army officers again ordered their men to fire on the crowd. men dissatisfied, disillusioned, tired of war, not only didn't fire on the crowd, some of them turned around and shot their officers. Total chaos. The Tsar abdicated less than a week later. His son, Alexei, was a hemophiliac. Nobody knew that outside the Tsar's family, but he was 15 years old. No way a 15-year-old boy could take over. So Nicholas said to his brother Michael, "Here, it's yours." And Michael said, "I don't want it." And the Russian Empire collapsed. It was a spontaneous revolution. Basically, none of the Bolsheviks, none of the Mensheviks were there. It's like the movie Network, if you ever saw it, when the guy looks out the window and screams, "I'm mad as hell and I'm not going to take it anymore." You probably can't put that on the tape. The people were angry. They were fed up. And it was a spontaneous revolution. Russia actually initially became the freest society on earth. Politicians formed a provisional government. They passed laws providing freedom of speech, freedom of worship, freedom of assembly. They set up universal suffrage, manhood suffrage, but still. The government supported political changes, but it didn't support any of the changes to help the peasants or the workers. They made no reforms in the land. There were still people paying redemption payments through about 1913, when finally one of the Russian Tsar's ministers, Peter Stolypin, said, "You know what? We better cancel the redemption payments. People are getting fed up." But people were poor because of two generations of paying the redemption payments. But the provisional government consisted of people who were, we'd probably call, proto-middle class. They had some property, some stuff, maybe a shop, maybe a house, maybe a business. They did not want to attack property. They just wanted political rights. So they created a government with political rights. But they made a really terrible mistake in the middle of it. Not that the refusal for land reform or the refusal for workers' reform wasn't a bad mistake. The provisional government decided to stay in the war. In my opinion, that sealed the fate of the provisional government. It took 6 months for Lenin and his minions to manage to overthrow it, but that critical mistake, if the provisional government had said, "We give, we don't care about our status, we don't care about Charles Darwin, we're just going to clean up our own house," Russia probably never would have come under communism. Instead, out in the countryside, the peasants started attacking town halls. They started attacking the estates of the aristocrats. They would burn the town halls down. Because if you burn the town hall down, how do you prove who owns the land? In the factories, the workers were basically kicking out the factory managers, running the factories themselves. In the field, this army that the provisional government kept, they heard about what was going back on back home, and another couple million deserted to vote with their feet to go back home and help mom and dad seize the family farm. I'm describing total chaos. Okay? In the midst of this, the Germans went, "Aha, that guy Lenin, he's a real troublemaker. If we send him back to Russia, wow!" So they packed Lenin up, put him in a sealed railway car, shipped him from Switzerland, wouldn't let him out of the train. It's like his ideas were going to leak out of the train. And they shipped him back to Petrograd. He arrived in April of 1917, and he said exactly what the Russian people wanted to hear. He called for peace. He called for land. He called for bread. He initially was supporting the desires of ordinary Russians. And ordinary Russians flocked to him because ordinary Russians wanted the war to stop. Ordinary Russians wanted land. Ordinary Russians wanted food. Workers in Petrograd created a committee that they called a Soviet, and that's where the term Soviet Socialist Republics come from, but it really is a Russian word that just means committee, issued Army Order Number 1. Again, those of you in the military, think what this would do. Army Order Number 1 included democratizing the army. So the men got to vote whether or not they were going to go fight. Okay? Great idea. It stripped the officers of their authority. Many enlisted men, not those who were at the demonstrations, just out in their units, after that order, just shot and killed their officers. Lenin was great at playing to the crowds. And one historian who was actually talking about the reign of Adolf Hitler said, the most important thing is what people think is true instead of what is true. And Lenin knew that. So he came up with all these wonderful slogans, and he made speeches all over the place to hundreds of thousands of people. Peace, land, and bread. All power to the Soviets. All land to the peasants. He was saying what ordinary Russians wanted to hear. And nobody seemed to worry about his inability to deliver his promises. He worked throughout the summer of 1917, destabilizing the government. Finally, in the fall, he managed to overthrow the provisional government, even though, in terms of card-carrying Bolsheviks, there were 260,000 of them, most of them in Petrograd. But Russia was 200 million people. Do the math. Isn't that 0.1%? But he managed to overthrow the provisional government. He solidified his support after the overthrow by saying, we're going to have peace with Germany. He said, everybody who's taken land, you can keep it. He didn't mean it, but he said it initially to get the support. He said, you guys who've taken control of the factories, you can keep control of the factories. And he called for a constituent assembly to write a new constitution for the new Russia. What was he doing? He was buying time, and he was buying popularity. He was consolidating his control. He was finding people in the army who were willing to support him. So when the Constituent Assembly met, 9 million of the votes cast for members to the Constituent Assembly were for Bolsheviks, 21 million for members of other political parties. When you put 9 million votes against 21 million, which is the bigger amount, 21 million, Lenin shut the Constituent Assembly down after one day, and the country sank into an incredibly violent, incredibly vicious civil war. The country he created terrified most people outside Russia. He nationalized industry. That's why my 10,000 share certificate is worth zip. Okay? He closed the churches. He colluded in the murder of nuns and priests. He imposed a reign of terror on the country with the secret police. And I'll give you an example. Hopefully we never see this here. Russians love circuses. They had little traveling circuses with gypsies, maybe a dancing bear, some acrobats, and they all had clowns. And out in the countryside, away from Moscow, away from Petrograd, there was a little traveling circus, and a clown came out and he started making fun of Lenin, and he started making fun of the Bolsheviks. And the crowd started to laugh. And the clown made more jokes, and the crowd started to roar. And in the crowd, Cheka agents, those are Secret Service agents, stood up and shot him. Okay, are you ever going to laugh at a joke about Lenin again? Are you ever going to trust anybody again? Mass terror remained a part of the Soviet state until its collapse in 1991. So how did that affect the peace treaty? Russia got out of the war, finally, in the spring of 1918. Russia got out of the war by ceding, basically, the western third of Russia to Germany. Its industrialized area, its bread, its heartland, because that was the only way. Germany was in Russia. There were German troops. Trotsky was opposed to this. Lenin's attitude was, look, there's going to be a world worker revolution after this war. Workers will overthrow the government of Germany, and they will give us the land back. The Germans moved their troops to the Western Front. There was the Western Offensive in 1918. It failed. Why did it fail? Russia moved something like 40 divisions. It failed because of the Americans. The Americans were in Europe, in force, fresh, well-fed, well-armed. The Americans were a major factor in the victory of the Allies against Germany. So you come to the peace treaty. How did the Russian Revolution affect the peace treaty? People have looked at the Treaty of Versailles and have said it was either too harsh or it was too gentle. Okay? Well, it was too harsh because it imposed war guilt just on Germany. Clause 231 said Germany was totally responsible for the start of the war. Okay? There are a lot of other, I mean, I could give you 50 reasons it started the war. Germany was responsible for maybe 10 of them. Germany, yes, it had undertaken submarine warfare. Yes, it had bombed Louvain. Yes, it had murdered nuns in Belgium. But other people are also responsible. So the Treaty of Versailles imposed reparations on Germany, crippling, horrendously huge, 33 billion Deutschmarks in reparations that Germany couldn't pay. Much too harsh, made the Germans angry. So why was it too easy? Because England, and to a lesser degree France, were worried about those big bad guys out in Russia. If we take the total army away from Germany, Russia is just going to come sweeping across Poland and sweeping across Germany, and it's going to obliterate life as we know it. So the Treaty of Versailles let Germany keep an army of 100,000 men. And I'm about 20 minutes over, but thank you for listening.